Well, thank you very much. And I'd like to welcome everybody to Northeastern University. And I'd like to start by giving you an idea of where you are. You may have been to Boston before, but perhaps you coming on the bus, don't really know where you're at. So this is Northeastern University campus in the center of Boston. So your conference is being held over here a little bit off the screen. This is the Charles River, that's MIT. This is Fenway Park, that was already mentioned. Here's the campus. This is the Museum of Fine Arts, which if you have a little free time, that's a good spot to go to, I recommend. And this is the building you're in right now. And so I want to give you a little bit idea about this building that you're in. And to do that, let's look at this picture from 1925, a little bit different than the one you just saw. This is one of the first aerial photographs of Boston. I wanted to show you one from 1915, but there were no photos from 1915. So the building that we're in is right here on the Fens Park, as you can see there. Let's zoom in on that a little bit, get a little bit closer view. There it is. So the part we're in is actually not in this picture because that was built much later, but this is the original building. There are a couple other interesting things around the neighborhood. This is the first YMCA in the United States, still there. This building here you might be interested in, this is the United Drug Company, which was formed when a number of formulary drug makers all got together and said, let's cooperate and unite. And so they did that. That produced the Rexall pharmacy chain. That building was sold to Northeastern in the 1960s. You can also see there was a huge rail yard here in this photograph, a turnaround to turn engines around and a lot of place to store engines. And then there's this huge empty field here. So if we compare 1925 to a couple years ago, recent aerial photo here, you can get an idea. There's the building we're in down here, and there's the addition, and we're directly into that roof right there of this building. You entered through the famous old part in the front that I'll talk about in a minute. There's the main part of the campus, and notice the difference between this big empty field and what it looks like now. So let's zoom in on this empty field, and let me tell you about why that's an empty field. So this is a picture from 1925, but in 1903, that's where they had the first World Series. And so it was held at this Huntington, baseball grounds before the Red Sox moved over to Fenway Park. And there you can see that roundhouse that I just showed you from the previous picture. So that this is all rail yard right behind here. And the pitcher that in that game was Cy Young. You can see they were selling these very salacious beverages, root beer and ginger ale, available in the park. Okay, so if you look to see where that is now, where would that sit? That's essentially right here on the campus. In 1912, that was closed down, and the Red Sox moved to their new field over here at Fenway Park. 1912 is an interesting year for what I want to tell you next, because that's the year that the building you're in was started. And so this building, the Forsyth Dental Infirmary for Children, was built for a cost of $2 million over the course of 1912 to 1914. That's something like $60 million today, maybe $60 billion, Boston prices. And this is what it looked like. And so the point of this was it was endowed by the Forsyth family. It was intended to be a spot where children could get dental care for free. And so in those days, by the time you learned that you had bad teeth, it was too late, they'd all fallen out. And children in general, especially poor children, had no dental care at all. And so they endowed this place. It opened in 1915, it was expanded, and the courtyard was filled later. That's happened here on the back side of the building. When you go out to see the posters, you're actually gonna be walking around in an atrium that's one half of the atrium are these windows that you can see in this picture here. So we are sort of floating in space right now in this addition that's just off the back here. In 2010, the Forsyth Dental Research Institute, which is one of the premier places for dental research, moved across the river to Cambridge, and the building was occupied in 2012 by Northeastern. This was the place to go for dental research when it opened. This was a picture of the operating theater in the front of the building. They put these big glass windows here on purpose so they have a lot of natural light, so they could see what they were doing. And they had 68 dental chairs going around here. And the building was of such importance that it was featured in Science magazine. When was the last time that you saw a science building that came out in Science magazine? Here it is, and I just wanted to show you a couple clips of this here. It was formally dedicated by the governor on the 24th of November, Tuesday, 1914. It later opened as a result of endowment from the Forsyth family, shown here. They started with around $3 million, $2 million to build it, $1 million to fund it. And the rest of their fortune that was given after the last Forsyth brother died funded the treatment of children at this in this facility for free until the present time. The other thing I wanted to show you over here is pretty interesting. So this is a fireproof building, one of the first fireproof buildings built. Talk about 1915 here. It's one of the most complete things that money could buy since they had an unlimited budget, as you can see here. And they had 68 chairs. And look at the incredible technology they had here. Running water at every chair, compressed air, suction, electricity. Many of the chairs had anesthesia. So, I mean, this was state of the art in 1903, all right? And the other thing I like about this is if you look down here, all the dental instruments were sterilized every night at 300 degrees Fahrenheit. That was also a new thing, okay? They weren't doing that on a routine basis before that. So if you have a lot of interest in it, I can take you down to the original sterilization rooms down in the basement. So, okay, that's where you are. That's the building. And I think, you know, to start off talking a little bit about higher order structure and what we're sort of doing here, I want to just start with this picture. So this is something that we all share, people interested in higher order structure. We're people with proteins. And we want to get from one side of this chasm across the valley of structural characterization over here to Xanadu, okay? And that may be a difficult thing for people to do. And so one way to get across there is to put some kind of a bridge or some kind of a solution. And you can imagine in your mind what those types of solutions could be. But this problem is actually a little more complicated than this cartoon because the valley often people have to cross is a little bit more like this. And the challenges that you have to face are you might not have any technology to get from here to here. If you don't have a crane or some ability to put a bridge across here, you're not going to get across there. You also might have no experience, meaning you wouldn't be able to climb down, get across, and climb back up the other side. You have to know what you're doing. You also might not be a bridge maker, so you wouldn't be able to get across there too easily. And okay, you're afraid. I mean, look at this thing, right? Who wants to try to cross that? In the beginning of getting across something like this, you throw a rope over there, and you skinny across the rope, right? In the beginning, there's always a lot of fear because it's not as well established. And so, you know, the things you have to think about are where's the hardware? You got to have some way to deal with this. On these days, you need software to bridge a gap like that. And then you also need to know something about proteins, because once you get to the other side, if you don't know anything about proteins, what are you going to do when you get over there? So one of the other problems that we have to think about is structural characterization. Most people think crystallography. Don't forget NMR is also included. I don't show that on this slide, because one of my points here is many of the proteins we're interested in won't crystallize. And so we don't have that option. In my experience, all the interesting proteins are the ones that won't crystallize. It's also a static picture. You get no information about movement, and you might need that. You might want that. And the other thing is, it's not really feasible to take the crystal structure of every protein that's ever made, meaning every lot of material that leaves your factory, you're going to take a crystal structure of that, or every PTM that you ever measure, or every binding to every compound or every complex, you're going to get a crystal of that. It's really not realistic. And so we need other kinds of tools, as you're all aware, that give us some structural information beyond sort of the coup de grace here or the gold standard, an actual crystal structure. And so, of course, the solution to all your problems is hydrogen exchange mass spectrometry, as you can see here. And there's a beautiful bridge that it forms across this chasm, okay? But there's a couple things you have to think about. If you're not a bridge builder, this needs to be a painless process, meaning when you're on this side, and you cross the bridge and get to the other side, you probably don't want to know that you're crossing. That's the best kind of bridge, right? So you need robust hardware, robust software, so it's just so easy for you to make this crossing. The other thing that's interesting is you don't want to be afraid when you go across here. So there are some bridges, and before this one was built, I remember there was wooden slats here, and when you were walking across, you could look down through the holes. This is in the Royal Gorge in Colorado, and you could look down the little slats, and okay, the average person's not going to walk across there because they're petrified. So you don't want to be afraid of doing this crossing either. And so the solution to that is education and training. So that's also a key component here. And then another thing that's really important is once you get over here, okay, now what are you going to do that you have this information? How are you going to use that information? So that's another key thing that you have to think about. So this hydrogen exchange method, I think probably everybody here has heard about this by now. This was a technique that was first described by this guy, Carl Linderstrom Lange, a famous Danish protein chemist in the 1950s, when he first showed that proteins in solution have these amide hydrogen positions that can switch places with the solvent. And so if you put a protein into a solution or a solvent that has an isotope, the isotope gets incorporated, and all you have to do is find the isotope. And so it didn't take long for people to make this measurement with a mass spectrometer, and so that's what we're going to talk about today, about how you can make that measurement. The first such measurement was made by Brian Chait in 1990, published in 1991. Vish Khata was the first author on that work. Vish is still working at Genentech. He's not here, right? Vish, are you here? No. I didn't think he was at the meeting. Still working in deuterium exchange. So that was of whole proteins. And the first people to show analysis of digested proteins was David Smith and Zhong Qizheng. Zhong Qizheng at Amgen, still doing deuterium exchange. And this was in 1993. And so the field in the past 25 years, we're celebrating 2015, the silver anniversary of hydrogen exchange, because the first work was done in 1990. Has looked like this. And so here's the publications and citations up until 2011. And we were lucky in the early days to get any recognition, but now we sort of have whole issues. We had a whole issue of the International Journal, a whole issue of BBA. And I'm pleased to tell you that there's a whole book coming now on this, which you can purchase in the second part of the year. This is 628 pages, organized by one of my previous trainees, who's David Weiss, now at University of Kansas. Put this book together. Some of you have chapters in that book. So that'll be a great resource for everyone. So the field is really moving along. And Waters got involved with this in 2005. And so they've been in the deuterium exchange business for 10 years. And I'll tell you a little bit about some more history about how that happened. So we recently did a survey of applications of the method in the last 2 years. It went from January to second quarter of June 2014. And this is by publication, so we had to pick a way to sort of do this, and so we decided let's look at the number of papers that were published. And clearly, academia and research institutes taking 70% of the publications. An interesting thing is 25% of the work is collaboration between industry, government, and academia. Industry and government don't show so well on this figure, but a lot of stuff that's done in those sectors is not published, and so it isn't represented in this diagram. And so I know there's a lot of stuff happening in industry, but it's just not possible to capture it in a figure like this. This is the distribution around the world. It's pretty much in every continent. We got to work on Australia a little bit. Clearly, the most work is done in the United States. I do have to say that 15% of the world output comes from my lab across the hallway. So that's a little disclosure. And that's one reason why the US is so red. But we've really been trying to get this out there in all kinds of places. And so we put systems in South America and in India and in Europe and trying to get this widespread. The things that this can be used for, according to this recent review we did, are shown here. And the larger the circle, the more uses for that. So interactions is something that's very popular. Structural characterization, development of methods. Folding of proteins is still pretty popular. Membrane proteins is something that's really coming on in the last couple of years, analysis of membrane proteins. Again, here's biopharmaceuticals, but the circle's small because, again, a lot of that work is just not put out into the public domain. And so you can do all kinds of things from looking at small molecule binding, large molecules, epitope mapping, look at amyloid fibrils, protein folding with chaperones, peripheral membrane proteins, etc. So I'll talk about a few of those things as we go along here. But I do know for sure that this technology is out there in biopharma, even though it's not represented in this kind of a diagram. And the reason I know that is because in this slide, which is 2 years old now, because I gave up trying to keep this up to date, because there are so many people that were doing this, I couldn't, every time I turned around, I had to change the slide. So I stopped doing this 2 years ago. These are the companies at that time that were doing this technology. And so many of the people that are in the room are represented by these companies or have done the work that's referred to in this slide. It also includes the regulatory bodies, and there are more than this now, but they also have this technology. And so, HD exchange has really come a long way since 1990. But I do have to say that it was not always as it is now. And so we didn't always have this beautiful bridge. Somebody had to build that. And so one of the things that we were very concerned about is what Mr. Natch is telling you down here, get the right tool for the job. Okay, well, we didn't have any tools for the job, so we had to make the tools. And one of the things that was really important to me anyway was to get this out there into hands of people besides me. It doesn't do really much good to develop a method in an academic lab if it just stays in that lab. And so commercialization was super important. So I think you have a general idea of what the method is like. This is sort of a diagram that shows what one does in an experiment like this. And the development of the method in the last 10 years has really followed five main areas, which are robotics, software, mass spectrometers, digestion, and chromatography. And so I want to mention a few of these things in the next few slides and sort of how that really has been going in these different areas. The first thing that we really focused on here was in 2005 with improving the chromatography. And so you saw a version of this in Ken's opening words. This collaboration that I've had with Waters has been going on for 10 years now. And we first showed that you could do deuterium exchange with UPLC in around the middle of 2005. That turned into a prototype system. By the way, you can see what's remaining of that prototype system in the window when you go past the lab here, on when you go out after for the poster session. There were several other versions of that that got published in 2008. Then there was a commercial distribution in 2011 with software and the first commercial product at ASMS in Denver. You could get that with robotics if you wanted, or the system here, the manual system with no robot. And then recently last year, this new M-class version appeared. The third version of the software came out. And as of last count, we're over 80 systems. Waters is over 80 systems deployed in the world. And so the data that I'm going to show you as we go through this here was all taken on this system. The system was built on purpose to do deuterium exchange. It wasn't taken from a bunch of other pieces of hardware that were meant to do another job and sort of smashed together. So we designed it with this in mind. And the development of the analytical practices for quench conditions was foremost. And so we really took a lot of pains to do that during the design of the system. All the mass measurements you're going to see are either from a Synapt or from a Zevo of a different flavor or another. Those happen to be fantastic for this because they have MS to the E, and that's an important component that I'm not going to have time to talk about, but that's really essential for this kind of an experiment. And then, of course, all the data have been processed with Dynamics now, and I have some data processed with various versions because we've been going along here from version 1 to version 3 in a pretty short time. So if you've not seen one of these systems before and you'd like to see one, we have quite a few across the way, which you're welcome to look at after the presentation. Here's a picture of a manual system. There's a two-pump UPLC here, and this is the heart of the system, the so-called HDX box, the chamber that houses all of the stuff that needs to be cooled down. Here you can see what it looks like when it's open. And here it is up against the Synapt G2. Here's a version of it when it is coupled with robotics. So this is a sampling robot across the top here that prepares a sample for you. Again, the UPLC pumps, the HDX box, and here it is interfaced to a Zevo. Here's a similar installation interface to a Synapt. This is from Rachel Garlish at UCB in the United Kingdom, who put that there so I wouldn't forget where this came from. This is a typical kind of installation you see in corporate world. And many of you have systems that look very similar to this. And so, as was also mentioned in the introduction, there are things across these five areas I described that have really pushed this to be much more easy, much more robust, a much better bridge for people that are afraid, and for people that have no experience, to actually pick this up, start doing these experiments, and get something useful out of it. And so that includes robotics. It includes this beautiful software package that allows you to process this data in a very fast way. And I'll show that to you in a few examples as we go. Again, the mass spectrometers are really paramount here. I'm going to talk about that in a second. Waters now sells its own pepsin digestion columns, which can digest proteins in high pressure, 10,000 psi. So that's also very useful if you need to use high pressure to force proteins to be cut into peptides. And as I already mentioned, this is the main center of the show here, this HDX box. So the latest thing that's been going on in the last couple of years is the introduction of this M-class UPLC, which can handle higher pressure, can go up to 15,000 PSI. That turns out to be really important for deuterium exchange because you can do analysis, and we're doing routinely 12,000 PSI now. You can do a separation in a much shorter time with higher performance. I'll show you an example in a second. Another thing that's really important is to use ion mobility. So if you have really large and complicated samples, for free, for no time cost, I didn't say money cost, but for no time cost, okay, you can do ion mobility all the time and give yourself another dimension of separation. And when you really have complicated mixtures, this is so, so important. So let me just give you an idea of what that might look like. So here's some of the peptide separation maps for digestion of a monoclonal antibody. This is something that a lot of people are doing. This is sort of typical of what you would see pre-M class, 8,000 PSI, 12-minute gradient, pretty nice separation. Here's what happens if you go up to 12,000 PSI by just raising the flow rate. Everything gets compressed slightly. Here's what happens if you turn on ion mobility, now go to halftime gradient, a 6-minute gradient. And so there are a few things that now start to overlap, but in general, 95% of the time, those are resolved in the mobility dimension. And so you don't even notice that this is shorter. What it does for you is it gives you more deuterium recovery and faster cycle time. You can now do twice as much as you were doing before because it only takes you 10 minutes to recuperate this column every time as opposed to something like 20 minutes. And so this ion mobility is fantastic because it allows you to separate things that have different drift times. Many of the peptides that overlap are separatable by this mobility. And again, you just turn it on. There's no downside to doing that. It only has positives. So this has really allowed us, as I'm going to show you in some examples now, to go to extremely complicated systems, very large and difficult things to work with, not the least of which are membrane proteins. And so in the last 5 years or so, we've really gotten into this membrane protein business. I'll show you a number of examples. But there are different ways you can do membrane protein analysis. You can put them in detergent, you can put them in liposomes, you can put them in nanodiscs, or you can bring them to Langmuir monolayers. And so I'll talk about a few of these as we go along here, but if it weren't for things like ion mobility and the ability to separate complicated things with UPLC, you essentially wouldn't be able to work with membrane protein very well. They have to be very small and only give you a few fragments, and then you can sort of do them with the old classical techniques, but UPLC will completely change the way you do membrane proteins, that's for sure. So let me spend some time talking about what you might actually already be doing if you're doing deuterium exchange in industry. This is a really short list of what people are doing with this now. In the research area, epitope mapping, structure function, PTMs, sequence changes, target protein binding, and the list goes on. And in development, you can do things like comparability and stability and formulation and folding and purification steps, and also that list goes on. And so I want to give you a few examples, but what these mostly have in common is they're usually a comparison of some kind. And so what you do in this kind of an experiment is you analyze what we're going to call desired protein and compare it to undesired protein and measure the deuterium exchange of those two forms. So you can actually define this in any way you want. I've done this because this is the one I want, and that's the one I don't want. The one I don't want gives me a very different signal than the one I do want, because in this case, this is unfolded. But you can imagine anything that you want to compare. Here's an example where we compare an innovator to a biosimilar, but you could also have a wild type and a mutant, or a deglycosylated and unglycosylated, or a protein-free and a bound to a small molecule, or whatever you want to compare. Both of these proteins that you're going to compare go through the exact same flow path of method analysis, and at the end of that, you compare the deuterium exchange in various peptides, and you look for regions where you see a difference. So here's a peptide that has a difference between the two forms. Here's one that doesn't have a difference between the two forms. And what you're interested here is where are those located? Not so much what the magnitude of the difference is. That's a separate question. I'm most interested, where is this protein different? And is it different at all? Okay, so that's the idea. So here's some data that was taken in collaboration with Damien Hood and Steve Berkowitz, who are here. I saw Steve anyway here somewhere. In collaboration with Biogen a number of years ago, where we looked at quality control of interferon, Avonex. And so what you see here are five peptic peptides after the protein's been deuterated and digested. And you are looking in each row here at two different states. And so there's actually a black line and a red line in each of these graphs. And the first one here is two different batches, one that's been in the freezer for 8 years and one that was freshly prepared. And so what you can see by looking at this is there are essentially no difference in deuterium incorporation for these five peptides as a result of being stored at minus 80 for 5 years. So that's good news. Maybe that's interesting to someone. Here's what happens if you pegylate the protein. So this is a comparison of pegylated versus non-pegylated material. And you can see pegylation basically doesn't do anything to the structure of this protein. And that was good news because actually Plegridy, the pegylated form of this, recently got approved by the FDA. And this type of information was in there in the approval pack. Here's another example where different media were used. And this is actually two reactor scale sizes where the media recipe is slightly different. You can also see scale up doesn't cause conformational alteration. And then down here you can see in the oxidized form of interferon, there are significant regions that are disturbed. And you can see that here by the increase in the amount of deuterium that's incorporated in several of these peptides. The oxidation product here is something that's not desirable. It doesn't have activity like the unoxidized. So that's something that you don't want. So you can easily measure interferon at any point and see if there's oxidation just by looking to see if the protein had been oxidized and then look to see if it messed up the conformation. And oh, by the way, we know where all these peptides are located. If you have the structure, you can just map them on there and you can say, oh, these are the effects of oxidation. This is where oxidation alters this protein. Here's some experiments that we did in collaboration with Bristol Myers, with Gudong Chen, who's also here somewhere, looking at GCSF. What are the effects of pegylation on GCSF? So what you're looking at here are peptic peptides going from N-terminus to C-terminus. And then you're looking at the difference in deuterium in each of those peptides between the wild-type version and the pegylated version. And you're looking to see if there are things that go outside the lines of significance, what one would call a significant difference. And those are these dotted black lines here. And so you see there are a couple of regions where there could be a small difference, especially here in the pegylated version. But overall, one would say, it's not too different. And so that's good news, right? If you're interested to find out if pegylation alters the structure of the protein. Here's some examples, not from my lab. This is taken from this Japanese group, published recently in JASMUS, also looking at GCSF after heat treatment. And you can see there's no alteration to the conformation upon heat treatment. After treatment with light to try to induce degradation, no alteration in conformation as a result of light degradation. And then forced oxidation. And I think even in the back row, you can see that there's major differences here upon oxidation. And so, oh, by the way, we know where all these peptides are. Those could be mapped onto the structure and so forth. But the key point is oxidation messes up the structure. These two don't really do anything. You could imagine you could do any kind of thing here, change the formulation, change the storage, change the excipient, you know, whatever you want to do, and see what happens. We did antibodies quite some time ago, 2009. This was, again, in collaboration with Biogen. Damien Hood was working at Biogen and came back to Northeastern to get his degree with me, his PhD. And in collaboration with Steve Berkowitz, we were the first to show that you could measure deuterium exchange in an antibody. And in 2009, we were afraid because we didn't know if we'd be able to separate all the peptides, 300-something peptides. If you tried that by HPLC, you wouldn't be able to do it at all. But we had UPLC then, and so we thought maybe we can do it. So we were able to do it, and here you can see some of the exchange data for this particular antibody. Many more publications have come since then. And in fact, antibodies are now pretty routine. This is one of the easy things that people do these days. In fact, so easy, you can do multiple ones in one day, no problem. So here's an example of a collaboration from my lab with Roche, looking at three different of their monoclonal antibodies. And here are an overlay of six randomly selected chromatograms for these antibodies. You can see the digestion is virtually identical. And in these particular four peptides here, you can see there are actually three lines in each one. And each data point, each circle is actually three data points per line. So there are nine data points for each of these things here. And by all measures of comparison, those are identical. And so I don't know the background and history of these monoclonal antibodies, but Roche was quite happy to see that they were all the same. And so you could imagine doing that in any kind of a situation. And this has started to be routine now. People do it on a regular basis. Here's some epitope mapping, also not taken from my lab. This is from some fantastic work done at Novartis, published in PNAS a couple years ago, looking at the interaction of a monoclonal on this factor H binding protein. There it is. And so they were trying to map the epitope by the standard methods using peptide arrays and phage display. And you can see here where they've mapped the epitope according to those techniques. And then you can see here where they mapped the epitope according to deuterium exchange, quite a bit different from the phage display. And then after all of these three assays were done, they managed to solve the crystal structure. And so you can see that the hydrogen exchange data most closely match what you see from the crystal structure of the actual interaction between the protein and its monoclonal antibody. And so while these methods don't, they're missing this whole piece over here. And so what I have been recommending, you know, to people for a long time is do an HD exchange epitope mapping experiment first, then you sort of know where you need to look. It's much cheaper and much faster than trying to do these methods, which might not give you everything, especially if it's a discontinuous epitope. If you look out and get a crystal structure, okay, great, but at least you sort of know here where to start looking, where things might be important. And you can make a mini peptide library instead of just poking around the dark trying to find where the epitope might be. Here's some work we did with Steve Blacklow's lab at the Dana-Farber and Harvard Medical School, mapping the epitope of a Genentech antibody. And you can see it here binding to this little protein, the notch nuclear regulatory region here, where the epitope that we described is shown in blue. These are regions where deuterium exchange was less in the presence of the antibody. So when the antibody bound, it protected it from deuteration, and you can see that here. So you would call that the epitope. An interesting thing happened when we compared this inhibitory antibody with the Fab version of that inhibitory antibody. You see that one of the areas here disappears, and we don't exactly know what that means. We speculate that there may be some dimerization going on with the full IgG that doesn't happen with the FAB. But still, you can see that the epitope maps to here. And so an interesting thing happened along the way, which was that Genentech had some activating antibodies. So in the case of this, that would be bad news. If you give this antibody to patients, you give them leukemia as opposed to cure them of leukemia. So this is not something that's going to go in patients. But to try to understand what's going on with the protein, it turned out to be quite useful. So you can see the antibody still binds with quite a high affinity, and the epitope maps to this blue region. But what also happens to the protein is these red parts become exposed. They unfold. And as we know already from activated versions of this protein, if this little lid here, which is sort of shown in pink in this little diagram here, if that lid unfolds and exposes this little facile bond here for cleavage, that's what causes activation of this protein. And so what was happening here was this antibody was pushing this lid enough so that this bond could be cleaved. While it bound tightly, it still caused activation. And so you learn something from this about the mechanism of activation, which you wouldn't have known if you were just doing mapping of these antibodies over here. So the point is you can screen lots of kind of antibodies and get lots of kind of information. Here's a protein-protein interaction experiment. Again, this is in collaboration with Bristol-Myers. Not necessarily epitope mapping because there's no antibodies involved here, but this is looking to see what happens when two proteins bind to each other. And this is a situation of adnectin binding to IL-23. IL-23 is composed of two chains, a P40 and a P19 chain. And when you compare exchange into IL-23 versus IL-23 bound to adnectin, you see decreases in deuterium incorporation in these blue regions here. And so you would speculate, oh, that's probably the epitope. The crystal was already known before we did this experiment. This is the crystal here. So we knew what the epitope was already. And you can see some of the deuterium exchange matches and some doesn't. And there are some regions here in the deuterium exchange that you don't see actual interaction in the epitope, in the crystal. And the reason for that is that these are regions like here and here, which are a little bit further away from the binding interface, that get stabilized as a result of binding. So you have to be careful when you're doing these kind of experiments. The number one way to deal with this kind of a problem if you don't have a crystal is just go now into these regions that you've identified and start making some site-directed mutants until you interfere with the interaction and you can easily tease out what's really in the epitope and what's a long-range or allosteric effect of binding or stabilization as a result of binding. We've done some work with these stapled peptide therapeutics. This is in collaboration with Alan Annis over at Aileron, and Greg Verdine, Laura Walensky, and Jay Bradner, and others in Harvard Medical School have shown that if you want to create a long alpha helical segment and use it as a therapeutic, you may be out of luck if you just synthesize that sequence, because often sequences that form helices like this, when synthesized, are unstructured. And so one trick to get around that is this method, so-called stapling them, where you incorporate two unnatural amino acids that can then cyclize. And so you can see that here. the actual side chain of the amino acids hooked together. And so this can stabilize the formation of a helix, and this is proven important for this example for borealin binding to survivin, but also for a number of examples. There are a couple of these staple peptides in clinical trial now. And so we wanted to test how deuterium exchange might be useful for looking at some of these. And so we looked at a number of stapled peptides, and this is a complicated figure, but I think the message is not so complicated. Here are four different versions of the same sequence with staples in different places. Unstapled, stapled amino acids, but not conjugated, a single staple and a double staple. And this is the deuterium exchange here from 10 seconds to 180 minutes. And you can see for the unstapled, it immediately is deuterated to the first time point and stays deuterated. So it's unstructured. This thing doesn't protect itself by forming a helix. And as you walk across here, you can see stabilization. The most stable form is the double stapled. In fact, it takes 3 hours for this thing to have the same deuterium level as you observe for this one that doesn't have the staple. And so that correlates very well with what you see in CD. So here, if you look at the CD spectra, just focus on the colors, the helicity goes up as you go across here, with this form down here being the most helical. And it also correlates with protease susceptibility. So these peptides are degraded very, very quickly by proteases. In fact, the half-life is very, very short, only a couple of minutes for the completely linear version that doesn't form a helix. And the more helical it becomes, the more stable it becomes. This double-stapled one here sticks around for hours because proteases are unable to digest it. And so this is just a small sampling of the work that was in this paper where we showed this. And this graph here is pretty useful because it actually allows you just to measure deuterium exchange at 10 seconds, so this first time point here, and there's a very nice correlation with protease susceptibility, which is a key question. And so these are seven peptides that were studied in that work. And one nice thing about this is they often have a different mass because they have different side chains and they have different cyclization. And so you can put all seven of those in there at one time and measure the deuterium exchange in one pot once because they're separated by their mass. And so this is a very easy way to quickly say which one of these staples causes a helix. And so the ones that you expect to cause a helix don't necessarily cause a helix. So you have to screen these things. And a great example of that is provided by this work that we've done with Lauren Walensky from the Harvard Medical School and Dana-Farber on apoptosis. And so this is a pretty complicated project, but let me just boil it down to the stapled peptide part of it. This protein Bax causes apoptosis when activated. So another protein comes along with an alpha helical region, interacts with that, and this causes the protein, the cells to kill themselves. This is the pro-apoptotic binding. Anti-apoptotic, so you can shut off this process, is afforded by a little alpha helix that binds down here, and that turns off apoptosis and the cells survive. So in various kinds of therapeutic strategies, you either want to kill cells, like cancer cells, for example, force them to go to apoptosis, or keep cells alive for various reasons. And so I want to talk about this little helical peptide here that's produced by this BCL2 protein. This is the protein, that little blue thing there is the helix from the protein. We wanted to see if we could make a stapled peptide version of that then you could use to force cells to stay alive. And so that was created here. A number of stapled peptides were created. I'm only showing you four here. And these X's that you see, that's where the staple was placed. And this is the helical wheel looking down on the end of the helix. Here you can see that same orientation looking down on the end of the helix. And these staples are placed in various places around here. And what you would predict causes stability is not what causes stability at all. And so that's why these have to be measured. And so the very interesting thing that you can see here is if you look at the deuterium exchange of these various stapled peptides, some of them are not helical at all. So if you put the staple in this position over here, this guy here, there's basically no protection. And it doesn't get additionally protected when it interacts with the protein. Same is true for the staple over here, which is this yellow orange one here. Basically no protection. This thing is very heavily deuterated from the first time points. If you put the staple down here, there is some protection. It's still fairly mobile. You see it get deuterated over the course of time. Another interesting thing is when you bind it to the protein, it gets more protected. So it's not totally helical, and then it is stabilized further when it interacts with its partner, with its target. But the most useful one from this set of peptides is here, where just the staple alone actually causes it to be quite stable, quite helical, and there's only a small amount of protection afforded to this thing when it binds to its target. And so this was the compound or the staple peptide drug version that was taken forward to look to see if we could see then what it would do to the target protein, if we could get it to inhibit this Bax protein. And so what you see here is a comparison of deuterium exchange in the wild type protein versus the wild type protein bound to that little peptide that's got the staple in there. And immediately what you can see is their protection from exchange right here and right here. This gray bar is the area of significance. Anything outside there means something. Peptides end to C are going across here. So you see immediately nice protection there. This lines up with some other data that people had speculated about. And a nice control is if you make a mutation in the stapled peptide that prevents it from going into the binding pocket, you can see that you completely reverse that. So it's not able to get into the pocket. It doesn't interface with the protein. There's no protection in that area. So you can immediately see what's happening. So this is an example of looking at something that you would expect to be helical. It not necessarily is helical, but you can measure that quite easily. You can see what happens when it interacts with targets. This is a peptide-protein interaction type of experiment. So this takes me to another thing that I think we've really started to get into recently that a lot of people need to reconsider if you're doing a lot of deuterium exchange, and that is, what do you mean by replication? And so depending on how you define that, you could process data 3 or 4 times and not take any new data. That's a type of replication. You could make one sample and then divide that sample into 4, like shown here, analyze those 4 things. Everything before the division is identical. It's a stock solution. And all the variability comes from what you're doing in the LC and the mass spectrometry. So you have analysis replicates, labeling replicates, manipulation replicates, and biological replicates, where you independently purify proteins from cell expression. You isolate those purified proteins. You take them all the way down through all of here. The most variables confront you when you do something like that. So if you look across here at the variability, processing replication gives you low variability. Biological replication gives you higher variability. But that's what we're really after, because we'd like to understand biology. And so the most value comes from the biological replicates, but unfortunately, they're not the easiest to do. It's very easy for people to just reprocess the same data. That's easy. But the value comes over here. So everything I'm showing you is multiple biological replicates, all of this data I'm showing you here. And so this is something that we really are keen on these days. So here's a series of biological replicates. This is looking at a DNA polymerase. And this DNA polymerase shown here interacts with DNA. And so in this chicletogram in the first panel, this is what happens to the polymerase when it interacts with DNA. You don't need to know anything else, except that there's protection in various parts. You can see it right here. Those, when mapped onto the surface of the protein over here, show you which regions take less deuterium when DNA binds. So there's actually a reorganization of the structure upon DNA binding. Great. The next thing that happens is this polymerase is trying to extend this little template DNA that we've given to it here. I don't know if you can read that, but the correct base pair is cytosine, not guanine. If you give it guanine to try to extend, it's not able to do anything. You see absolutely no extension, and you see no modification to the protein structure. But if you give it cytosine, the correct nucleotide, it can actually incorporate that into the DNA, and there's a conformational change. And what happens is the protein goes into a situation where it closes down slightly on the DNA and the nucleotide in order for the catalysis to happen so that it can add it on to the growing nucleotide chain. So you can see that happening right here. And so this is the cartoon of what that looks like. And so that was further extended. Oh, and so by the way, I forgot to tell you, this is 3,000 measurements you're looking at here. Here's one with 7,000 measurements, 7 different conditions. This looks complicated. It's not so complicated. This is a polymerase that can correct damaged DNA. And so if you put a damaged nucleotide base in this position that it's trying to extend by putting this N2 furyl guanine there, or you put an O6 methyl guanine there, you do that on purpose, then you can look to see, can this polymerase bypass this damaged DNA and extend this sequence? And so to the answer to that is shown here. So here's if you have the N2 furyl modification or damage to the DNA. It's not able to extend with the wrong nucleotide. We already know that from the previous one. But here it can extend no problem. It can do that close down that I just showed you and then catalyze that reaction. And you can also see it here from these activity data where what you see here is with time, you can see that the primer gets extended to longer pieces of DNA because it can start to polymerize this thing and it gets longer. And you can see that. This polymerase is not able to fix this damage. So when you have this O6 methyl, you can see nothing happens in the deuterium exchange, which is in line with what you see here. It cannot extend that. It's not able to fix this problem. And so you can automatically go, and if you wanted, you could screen, which we've done, lots of different kinds of modified bases and see which ones the polymerase is capable of dealing with and what happens to the conformation when it's doing that. And so this is sort of what I wanted to tell you, and this is the wrap-up of that, which is we're really trying to push this technology. We push it at a point now where we can work with 1,000 amino acid proteins. The average person would be happy to work with a 50 kilodalton protein, 300 residues, or even with a growth factor small protein. That's easy now, very easy for you to do. Get the gear, done. Take my training class, you'll know what you're doing, and you can go ahead with that. And there are many people in the room who have done that already. And we're going to keep going here and working on these much more complicated, interesting systems. I have some even other more complicated things I didn't show you. Mega Dalton complexes, for example, that we'd like to study. This has to be commercial. As I said before, everybody has to have access to this. That's why I teamed up with Waters so that this could be put out for everybody to have access to this. There's actually two reasons for that. One is there are a lot of projects, and you should have access to this equipment to work on your projects. The other reason is that if you don't have access to the equipment, you come to me, and I don't have enough people and enough time to do all your projects. So we want to train everybody in the world to be able to do this on their own, and so that's really the goal. Okay, let me acknowledge all these people. I definitely want to acknowledge my research group, most of whom are here. Several of them are soon to come on the job market, so if you'd like to set up deuterium exchange in your company, they are here, and I could introduce them to you, no problem. Here's some people from the past from my group that contributed some of the slides you saw. Here is the short list that I tried to keep updated of all the important people that had something to do with the formation of this instrument from Waters over the years. And if I somehow neglected your name here, you're part of this et al. Down here. Basically, all of Waters was involved in this, as Ken mentioned in the beginning. Developing an instrument doesn't happen in 6 months. I mean, this is a year-long process. It involves people that are in the manufacturing and the service and the sales and the marketing and the safety and all of that. And so they were all super important. You know, none of this would be here if it weren't for these people that made the hardware, made the software, decided, yes, that's a good idea, we should sell that, et cetera. These are some of my collaborators these days. I like to acknowledge all these guys because they give us really hard problems to work on. And with these really hard problems, we can really push this technology. That allows us to go to the next level and make the stuff that we thought was hard routine. And so this pushes the method forward. And so all these guys have really interesting and challenging projects that we're trying to push this technology with. And let me acknowledge all these various sources of funding down here, not the least of which is Waters, who have fitted out the lab you're about to see here, if I'll ever stop talking. I'm going to end with this slide just to remind you where you are. There you are. Okay. And I don't think we're going to do questions. Is that right? I think we're going to go immediately to the food. That's right. I'll be here if you have a question, okay? Thank you very much.